our fifth speaker, Dr. Hala Aljarory. Dr. Hala is Saudi board certified in perinatal neonatal medicine. She graduated 3 months ago. She's working at King Abdul Aziz University Hospital, Jeddah. She will present to us her research about routine gastric residual aspiration in preterm infant and the effect on the reaching full feed. Dr. Hala.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure to present my research today under the title of Routine Gastric Residual Aspiration in Preterm Infants and the Effect on Reaching Full Feed. Gastric residual is routinely evaluated in preterm infants with NGT or OGT. It is performed before feeding to predict feeding intolerance or necrotizing enterocolitis. And as we all know, nutrition in the NICU is considered one of the most challenging and important aspects of the neonatal care to optimize the clinical outcomes of the fragile and at-risk population. Routine GR aspiration can delay the achievement of full enteral feeding with its consequences of extrauterine growth retardation, cholestasis, and increased risk of sepsis. There was one study published in 2015, Turaza et al. Demonstrated in an RCT that very low birth weight infants randomly allocated to the no routine GR aspiration group reached full feeding of 150 ml per kg per day 6 days earlier and had 6 days fewer on central lines access. The routine practice of gastric aspiration works as a forecaster for feeding intolerance and necrotizing enterocolitis, and high GR volume was thought to reflect the distal intestinal necrosis. On the other hand, discarding this gastric residual will lead to the loss of hydrochloric acid, which is an important factor to prevent bacterial overgrowth, which will lead to inflammation and the increased risk of sepsis and NIC. There was one study published in 2004. It's a case-control single-center study. Cobb et al. Studied 51 very low birth weight infants with NIC and compared them to 102 controls, where GR volume was evaluated 6 days before the diagnosis with NIC. Those who were diagnosed to have NIC had a maximum GR of 4.5 ml, compared to 2 ml in the control group. Despite being statistically significant, there was an overlap between the residual volumes in both groups. There is yet no national or Arabian study in this field. So our rationale, to our knowledge, this is the first study from Saudi Arabia evaluating the effect of routine GR elimination on reaching full feed. And we hypothesized that infants not receiving routine GR evaluation would reach feed of 120 cc per kg per day 3 days earlier than infants undergoing routine GR aspiration. And the aim of our study is to evaluate the effect of routine GR aspiration in preterm infants on reaching feed of 120 cc per kg per day. It's a randomized clinical trial. We included preterm infants less than 32 weeks gestation, excluding any proved or suspected chromosomal abnormalities, any gastrointestinal tract abnormalities, any patients with hypoxic insult. So the primary outcome is the time of reaching feed of 120 cc per kg per day in preterm infants less than 32 weeks with routine GR aspiration compared to those in which the aspiration was not routinely performed. And the secondary outcomes included number of days until reaching the feed of 150 cc per kg per day, the number of days on TPN, the incidence of sepsis, NIC, and the weight gain grams per day for the first 3 weeks of life. So an independent researcher provided sequentially numbered, opaque, and sealed allocation envelopes using computer-generated random numbers, and the biostatistician was blinded to the assignment of the groups. The ethics committee, the ethics review board at King Abdulaziz University Hospital, approved the study. For the feeding protocol, we're following the Saudi Neonatology Society feeding protocol. And we had a scheme in case any problems happened in the middle, any vomiting or abdominal distension, for the physicians, for the team to be followed. For the statistical analysis, prior to the experiment, we ran a pilot study of 40 subjects to obtain the variance estimates needed in determining the sample size. With the existing feeding protocol that we have, the average time for infants less than 32 weeks to reach 120 ml per kg per day of feeding was 12 days, with a standard deviation of 6 days. So we hypothesized that no routine gastric aspirate will decrease the number of days to reach 120 ml per kg per day by 3 days. So 126 patients were required to have an 80% chance of detecting as significant at the 5% level a 3 days decreasing in the number of days to reach 120 ml per kg per day feeding in the no routine gastric aspiration group. For the statistical analysis, SPSS for Mendes was used, and the continuous variables, we used the student's t-test when they were normally distributed, and Mann-Whitney-U test when skewness in the distribution is observed. And for the categorical variables, we used chi-square test, and the p-value of less than 0.05 was considered significant. This is an interim analysis, as we have 40 patients currently in the research, and we need 126 patients. So a total of 40 patients, 20 patients in each arm. For the baseline characteristics of the infants, there was no significant difference in both groups in terms of the birth weight, gestational age, booking, CS, dexamethasone receive, the gender, IUGR, being exclusively on EBM, and the central line. And here we notice that we have a less booking percentage, only 55% in each group. And very few patients on exclusively EBM. For the primary outcome, which is dates to reach 120 ml per kg per day feeding, in the no NGT group, it was approximately 14.4, the mean was 14.4, with a standard deviation of 6.3. And in the NGT routine aspiration group, it was 16.5 days, with a standard deviation of 9.9. Despite being statistically insignificant, there was approximately 2 days difference between the two groups. For the secondary outcomes, days to reach 150 ml per kg per day, there was no statistical difference between both groups. For the other outcomes, there was no significant difference between both groups in terms of the incidence of IVH, PDA, sepsis, necrotizing enterocolitis, the inotropic use, the weight gain gram per kg per day, the TBN duration, the central line duration, and the mortality rate. And as we can observe, the sepsis incidence is high, 60% and 35%. And the necrotizing enterocolitis did not actually differ between both groups. The TBN duration, there was approximately 2 days difference in the mean, but it was not statistically significant. The mortality rate was 20 and 30%. So the strength of this study, it's a randomized clinical trial, and the quality measures followed for the RCT. It's the first study in Saudi Arabia on the effect of nasogastric aspiration on reaching the feed of 120 ml per kg per day, and we followed the protocol feeding strictly. The limitation is the high incidence of sepsis, which could be related to the high incidence of unbooked cases. In a conclusion, still, this is an ongoing study, but despite being statistically insignificant, no routine gastric residual aspirate leads to reaching feed of 120 cc per kg per day, 2 days earlier and 2 days less on TPN. The incidence of NIC was not different between patients receiving routine gastric aspirate and those who did not. Special thanks to Dr. Saad Asadi, Dr. Haider Al-Wasiya, my NICU team, and King Abdulaziz University Hospital. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hala. Now we open the floor for discussion. Any question?
Yeah, the presentation is very good, well prepared and well written. Doctora, you're speaking a little fast. Just pace a little slowly. It will have been much better. The conclusion, I disagree with your line saying there are 2 days difference because there was not statistically significant, so there was no difference yet. Maybe after you recruit the entire population, it will be different. My question to you, did you register this trial on like clinicaltrial.gov?
Unfortunately, no. I did not register this trial. And
please do it as soon as possible.
Okay.
Because this is an excellent trial. It will get published. So many journals required has to be registered before recruitment. So just do your best and try to register it as soon as possible.
Inshallah. I have a comment. For the other trial, then, for the same outcome, there was a 6 days difference, but yet it was not statistically significant. Yes, for sure, we'll have the final results once I'm done with the whole sample size, but just to mention that. Thank you, Dr. Hani.
I also would like to suggest, if you can, because you're biological plausibility, you think you will be better because you are controlling the pH better. You are not losing the hydrochloric acid. So it will be very helpful if you record the morning time. You don't need to do any extra investigation. Just record the blood gas from each day in the morning to see where is the base deficit. Is there any difference or not? It will be interesting to have it in your results when you write the paper.
Okay. Thank you so much, Prof.
Yeah, I think the sample which you are taking is all babies less than 32 weeks, which is a quite heterogeneous group of babies. Mm-hmm. You may be having babies as small as 25 weeks or 24 weeks.
Yeah.
And at the same time, you're also including some IUGR babies, which is a problem for feeding anyway. So I think probably you need to look back into that, your sample size and the contents of that sample as well.
Well, there was no difference between both groups in the gestational age and the IUGR. Both were equal so far.
Yeah, but what I mean to say is that feeding of inappropriate for gestational age is a different thing than feeding a growth retarded baby.
Yes, true.
Yes, please, Dr. Zakarias.
Thank you very much. I like this study because it's a randomized control trial. So, but I have a concern about it, which is the prevalence of, when you calculate your sample size, it depends on so many things. One of them is the prevalence of the disease in your place. Mm-hmm. And when I look at the rate of necrotizing, at least in the data you are showing us, it's 30%. That's a little bit high. I think you might face a problem later on in getting it published. Even if it gets published, they will say the applicability of your study will be a little bit, people will not be able to generalize your findings because the rate of necrotizing is very high. I don't know what you will do to decrease this. This is a priority. Before doing a study, if the rate is 30%, I think the priority should be decreasing it by anything rather than to recruit patients for randomized control trial, because we have so many things, and Dr. Han yesterday mentioned so many things that we can do to decrease the rate of NEC. What's your comment about that?
Well, my comment is that between the routine gastric aspiration, it's not a real predictor. There is no enough evidence that a real predictor can be used for necrotizing enterocolitis.
Or it could be the diagnosis, the diagnostic criteria. Do you really have 30% NEC? Every 10 babies, 3 of them go for surgery for NEC? Or we maybe just everybody with little distinction will call him having NEC. So maybe a good idea if we do more strict criteria for identifying what is really called NEC. If you don't see a clear nematosis in the X-ray, then that would be stage one. We can just call some feeding intolerance, not a real NEC.
In case the patient was symptomatic, aspiration would be done for the patient.
I'm trying to answer the previous question.
Okay.
When you are saying necrotizing enterocolitis with 30%, it may be a better idea when you are reporting, you report only stage 2 or 3 NEC. Babies who had nematosis on X-ray, or baby who went for surgery because of NEC. If you include only these, the rate of NEC would be much lower.
Okay, thank you.
Doctora, in your interpretation for the increased sepsis and those who had gastric aspirates done, you mentioned that because of the you are clearing the hydrochloric acid. But do you really need to throw it away? Why don't you just put it back?
There is no standardized management for the gastric residual aspirate. Some units, they would return it, and some units would discard it. So there is no standardization, actually.